Welcome to episode 12 of Terrain Rendering. In the previous tutorial of this series, we developed the skybox to enhance the realism of the sky above our terrain. The skybox depends on a complex texture with six faces that must be aligned perfectly against each other to avoid visual glitches. In this video, we will have a different technique to accomplish the same job. Enter the Skydome. The main advantage of the Skydome over the skybox is that it allows us to use a procedurally generated texture. This makes the Skydome much more flexible compared to the skybox and also enables a wider range of animations, stars for example. Theoretically, the Skydome is more computationally complex, but I suspect that in many cases you won't be able to tell the difference in performance compared to the skybox. Before we get started, I'd like to say a big thank you to Preston, who recently joined the OpenGL Underground. If you too would like to support this channel, you can do that at patreon.com/OGLDEV or by joining the YouTube channel as a member. For the skybox, we used a simple model consisted of 8 vertices and no textural coordinates. Instead, we used the position vector to fetch texels from a cube map. In the case of the Skydome, we will dynamically generate both the triangles and the textural coordinates to tessellate a sphere. While it is possible to simply use a model that was created offline specifically for this task, the dynamic approach allows us much more freedom to choose the level of resolution, or the size of the triangles, each time the system starts up. It's also interesting to study the geometry of it all, so why not? Let's take a look at how to create the geometry of the Skydome. As I said, this is a simple sphere, and we know that every point on the sphere satisfies the following equation. This means that summing up the squares of the components of the position vector equals to the square of the radius of the sphere. We're going to approximate the sphere using triangles, so the simplest way to do that is to go around the sphere in long stripes, as well as from top to bottom. The size of the triangles will be determined using two variables, the number of columns as we go from left to right, and the number of rows as we go from top to bottom. From these two, we can calculate two angles, the heading angle between two consecutive vertical lines, and the pitch angle between two consecutive horizontal lines. In formal math literature, you will often see the usage of the Greek letter theta to represent the pitch angle and phi to represent the heading, but I find pitch and angle easier to use. Given these angles, it's actually simpler to switch from the Cartesian coordinate system to the spherical coordinate system. In the Cartesian system, we of course use offsets from the origin along the x, y, and z axes. In the spherical coordinate system, we use the pitch, the heading, and the radius to specify the location of every point. If you check the Wikipedia page on the spherical coordinate system, as well as other sources, you will see this strange-looking image with the z-axis pointing up. If you scroll down, you will see the equations to translate from spherical to Cartesian. As I said, I find this to be quite cumbersome to use, and I ended up using the convention that I found in the 3D Math Primer. This book uses the left-handed coordinate system by default, which makes life easier for me, because that's the system that I'm using. The book replaces phi and theta by pitch and heading, respectively, and sets the zero value of both to point along the positive z-axis. If you've ever seen a movie where they talk about flying straight on heading zero, it should make sense to you. The combination of zero pitch on the z-axis and the left-handedness of the system means that the apex point of the sphere is actually at minus 90 degrees, and as we go from the y towards the x, the angle increases until we reach zero, where y is also zero. This provides the following function to convert from spherical to Cartesian. Always remember that the trigonometric functions in the standard library take the angles in radians and do the proper conversions. If you want to understand how these equations were developed, you can check the link in the video description for a free online version of the Math Primer book. The creation process of the sphere will include two for loops. one for the pitch angle and one for the heading angle. At each iteration, we will translate the current spherical coordinates to Cartesian coordinates, and this will allow us to construct the triangles as usual. A few things to note here. First, we only need to construct half of the sphere. I'm sure you guys know that the Earth is flat, and so is our terrain. This means that we can place half of the sphere above the terrain, lower it a bit so it goes below the horizon, and this will give the viewer the sense of an actual sky. You will need to play around with how much you need to lower the sphere, because if you allow the camera to go too high... yeah, that's weird. So the bottom line is that the range of the pitch angle is only 90 degrees, while the heading angle must go the entire 360 degrees. Second, most of the horizontal strips will be constructed from quads made up of two triangles. We've seen this several times already, so no problem there. The exception is the topmost strip that goes around the sphere apex. As you can see here, in this case we have a series of triangles that share the apex vertex. So we will need one piece of code to construct the common strip and a specialized one for the topmost strip. Third, the camera is placed inside the Skydome. This means that we need to make sure that we can actually see this side of the triangles. We can either construct the triangles to be visible from outside of the sphere and reverse backface culling. This is actually the method that we used for the skybox. The alternative is to make them front-facing from inside of the sphere. This will save us the need to change backface culling every time. I chose this option. This is just a matter of playing with the order of the vertices until you get it right. Okay, so this function populate buffers of the Skydome class creates the actual sphere. It takes the number of rows, the number of columns, and the radius as parameters. Starts by calculating the total number of vertices, which we need in order to resize this vector, which will eventually go into the vertex buffer. Next, it calculates the two angles, the pitch and the heading. It initializes one vector here for the apex of the sphere, which is going to be reused for the topmost strip. We create this strip right here by going all around from 0 to 360, and we initialize three vertices each time. Okay, so first we have the apex, which is reused, and a couple of vertices below the apex. Okay, because the apex is located at minus 90 degrees, so by adding the pitch angle, we go to the next row below it. So the two vertices share the same pitch, and for the heading, we use the current iterator of the loop and the next one. And this function init by spherical coords translates from the spherical coordinates to the Cartesian, as we saw earlier. So we have the top strip, and then the rest is here. We need to go over all the rows and the columns, and in this case we have a quad of four vertices, and we initialize two triangles. In order to render the Skydome, we initialize a world matrix which places the Skydome at the position of the camera, and we also bring this down a bit, as we saw. The view and projection matrices are as usual, so we can create the WVP matrix for the Skydome and put this into the vertex shader. Next, we bind the texture, which we will not use at the initial stage, but we will need this later when we add texture coordinates. Next, we change the depth function to less than or equal. This is a trick that we saw in the previous tutorial on the skybox, so make sure you check that out. This is part of making sure that the Skydome comes after all the other objects in the scene. We can now bind the VAO and call the draw function. In the vertex shader, we transform the position to clip space as usual, and we also set the Z to be equal to W. Again, this is part of the trick that I mentioned. And we also send the original Y component of the position vector in local space to the fragment shader. we will use that to interpolate between two colors. So we are kind of assuming here that this will be between 0 and 1. So in the fragment shader, we have a couple of colors here, a low color and a high color, and we use the height to interpolate between them. So this is the initial implementation of the Skydome, and if we choose the colors properly, we can sort of convey the feeling of a sunset. Sort of. The next step is to add the textural coordinates so that we can map real textures on our Skydome. This can be tricky to get right because not all rectangular textures look correct when applied on a sphere, but since you can get good results on Unity, then I guess it can be done. The textural coordinates generation process is actually very simple, and I'm using a method which I found online called spherical mapping with normals. Let's assume that the radius of the sphere is 1. This means that along the equator, x goes from minus 1 to 1. This range, of course, becomes shorter when we go above the equator. We have a similar thing with y, except that it goes from 0 to 1, since this is half of a sphere. Remember that the sine function of 90 degrees is 1, and for minus 90 degrees, it is minus 1. We will use the reverse sine function, aka arcsine, to map the x component of the position vector to the original angle. The result is in radians as usual, and in the case of 1, we get about 1.57. If we divide this by pi, we get a half. We can do the same thing for minus 1 and get a negative half. So now all we need to do is to add a half, and we've got ourselves a textural coordinate, which is linearly interpolated along the face of the sphere. Y is the same, of course. And that is it for today. I know it's a very basic Skydome, but I do plan to improve it in the future. So make sure to subscribe. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you in the next tutorial.